Ram, before we start with the obvious and worrying fault lines that beset our republic, let me, as I said I would, start with the fact that 5 weeks ago, this government marked 4 years in office. It came to power in 2014 promising Achhe Din. To what extent has that target or that goal or that ambition been achieved?
Well, when politicians run for office, not just in this country, and particularly if they're in the opposition trying to unseat an established regime, they promise a great deal. So I think in the spirit of fairness, one should note that every politician running for office as an outsider would promise a great deal. Virtually no government in history has achieved what it promised to do. So having said that, clearly there are many things this government has not promised. There are many respects in this prime minister seems to have, if not betrayed, betrayed maybe a too strong a word, let down many of the people who voted for him. But I'd like Karan to remind the audience of why so many people voted for Narendra Modi in 2014. I think part of it was to do with his projection of himself, partly accurately, as completely self-made. And his ability to make that contest presidential, even though we are not a presidential system, to oppose himself to someone who came from a family of entitlement and privilege. That's reason number one, I think people are attracted to him. The second reason people are attracted to him was, again, a very clever and important positioning that he did. Now, there are people in this room who have covered the 2002 riots in Gujarat. I have known Gujarat all my life. I go there often. I went there shortly after the riots. I went to the Sabarmati Ashram after the 2002 riots, and someone there described, a veteran Gandhian described those riots to me as the second assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. Now, and anyone who lived through that period knows how awful and horrible those riots were. And Narendra Modi, as chief minister, was certainly culpable for not doing enough to stem them. However, he and his supporters and his spin doctors were able to remind the voters that 18 years before 2002, 1984 happened in this city, and another regime, a Congress regime, presided over by Rahul Gandhi, did nothing to stop those riots. And to all those who said that it's been 12 years since justice was promised to the victims of the Gujarat riots, he was able to remind people that it was 30 years since justice was promised to the victims of 1984. So I think there are reasons why he was attractive. Forget what he promised, because everyone promises things.
But you will come to what he promised, because the question
of
was,
course I will.
To but what I, extent know, I, has he delivered Achhe Din?
Absolutely. But I think I'd like to remind people, because it's very important in an audience like this, which is partly a self-reflective audience. Now, I don't want to subject you to a hold up your hands test, but I suspect 90% of you are like me, who have never voted for the BJP. Right. Now, it's important for us to understand why many other Indians, including non-communal Indians, vote for the BJP. And that's why I'm giving you this background. You know, I think it's very important, especially for young people, to recognize this. So I think that's, he came on a wave of, if not goodwill, the fact that the other side had more ill will than even he did. Right. Now, I think that was his very successful presentation of his personal desire and ambition to be prime minister. And the promises are secondary, they come later. But it's very important to remind people, because, you know, I find that among many sensible people, there is a lack of awareness of the revulsion for the old established Congress regime that was here, especially in its second term between 2009 and 2014. Among many people, there is also a lack of understanding that ordinary Indians have against a fifth generation dynast leading the party of the freedom struggle. So I think we have to understand all of this. It's very important. You know, the poet Keats talked about negative capability. How do you understand what somebody else is thinking? You know, and there are some great anthropologists in this room. They know what it takes to to understand a completely alien culture. And you have to enter that worldview to understand why A, Narendra Modi won in 2014, B, why among large sections of the population, despite the awful performance of his government, despite the violence promoted by many of the cadres of the Sangh Parivar, Narendra Modi still remains popular. So I think this is very, so I would like to, that's why I'm spending some time on this. We must have this understanding as to why a person rightly criticized, often and sometimes rightly reviled, still enjoys popularity among large sections of the population outside this room.
But my question, if I can come back to it, was answered partly or hinted at partly by one sentence. You said the awful performance of this government. So are you also in that sentence encapsulating the thought that Achhe have not been delivered?
Absolutely.
At all?
Yes.
In no shape and form?
Well, certainly I'm not a specialist in economics, but even a non-specialist like me in economics can say that demonetization was an absolute disaster. Even a non-specialist in economics can say that GST, while perhaps well conceived, has been badly executed. And if you leave out economics, clearly, in terms of polarizing and dividing society, in terms of undermining public institutions, in terms of being silent when his own senior cabinet members are attacked by members of his own political family, this has been an awful government. Absolutely. But I want to just give the context about 2014, but on what this government has done, and as Prime Minister, a Prime Minister who is certainly the most powerful Prime Minister than Indira Gandhi, that is, who runs, just to a story for young people here. I'll come back to Narendra Modi in a minute, but a story for young people here about Indira Gandhi. Now, she went to America for the first time in the late 1960s, and President Johnson didn't know how to address her because he'd never dealt with a female prime minister. Should be Indira, Mrs. Gandhi. And he asked the Indian ambassador, and the Indian ambassador, who was actually a relative of Indira Gandhi at the time, asked her what should he say. And she said, well, my cabinet ministers call me sir. Right. Now, the point of telling this story, Karan, is to say that he is the most authoritative, not to say authoritarian, prime minister since Indira Gandhi. Unlike, say, Manmohan Singh or Vajpayee or Narasimha Rao or even Rajiv Gandhi, where independent cabinet ministers had authority, autonomy, responsibility. So we could say so-and-so goofed up when there was a communal riot, the home minister goofed up. Here, the buck actually stops with him.
I'm going to strike a bargain with you. We'll make greater progress if you restrict your answers to the question I asked.
Okay.
Otherwise, every answer is covering the next six questions that are lined up. Right?
Okay.
This is going to sound a bit like a redundant question, but maybe I can tempt Ram to say something he hasn't said, because I was going to say that the second key issue I want to raise is Narendra Modi himself.
Yes.
What is your assessment of his performance as India's chief executive?
I think it is, the only one thing that can be said in his favor is that he works incredibly hard.
But ineffectively.
But he is always alive and alert. Well, sometimes ineffectively, sometimes malignantly. But he's always working.
I get the feeling, Mr. Modi is not your idea of the ideal prime minister.
You can say that again.
Now, they say comparisons are odious, but they're not just inevitable. Indians find them irresistible. How would you compare this BJP prime minister to the only other BJP predecessor he's had, Atal Bihari Vajpayee? And how would you compare him to Indira Gandhi, a woman a prime minister, I should say, that the RSS and the BJP both love to hate, but also hate to admire?
So first with Vajpayee. I think other people who are more knowledgeable than me and who understand the minutiae of administration say that Vajpayee ran a more collegial cabinet. He consulted with people. And he had to do partly because he was in a coalition. But I think the real difference between Narendra Modi and any other prime minister we've had ever is that for successes, real or imagined, he is not willing to share the credit with anyone else. Not even with Lord Rama. Okay. No, I think that's it. And I say this because, Karan, I have always, to many of the you in this room have thought this. But 6 months ago, I was driving from Bangalore, which is in the south of my state, to beyond Dharwad, which is in the north of my state. And that's a drive I did many times in the 90s and early 2000s when I was doing field work in northern Karnataka. I was going after 10 or 12 years, and the roads were really good. And I thought to myself, these roads are partly good because it's the highway to Bombay, and it was part of Vajpayee's golden quadrilateral. Why doesn't Modi talk about it in the Karnataka election? Because he cannot come to Karnataka and say, Vajpayee ji ne ye acha kaam kiya, main usko aage lena chahta hu, because he cannot even share credit with Vajpayee. Right. So that's the first thing. And the second thing, of course, which everyone knows, that if something goes wrong, he won't accept blame for that either.
Can I venture an interruption there?
Please.
You've given the credit to Vajpayee, who stopped being Prime Minister in 2006, overlooking the fact that for the last 6 years there was a Congress government. And is it possible that praise stuck in Mr. Modi's gullet because it was Sidharamaiah he'd be praising?
No. I don't think so. I think you know, in that sense, he is a study in self-love. You know, I think it would take the combined skills of Ashish Nandi, Sudhir Kakkar, and some young psychoanalysts in this room to provide a deep. I think it's really, I think there has been, so that is part of it. You know, Indira Gandhi also loved herself. Any person in power loves themselves. I mean, Virat Kohli loves himself, right? You know, Mukesh Ambani loves himself. To get to the top of any profession, you have to have some belief, strong self-belief. But this is what is extraordinary. I mean, look at what other people have noticed. You know, he's referring to himself in the third person. The suit which had his full name, Narendra Damodar Das Modi. So I think it's all of this that makes him, that is, as I said, you know, there was Lord Ram and then there was Narendra Modi. Right? So that is really what is, to me, as you know, I'm a biographer too. I mean, I write about individuals. So I have some rudimentary understanding, not as much as a psychoanalyst would, about how people perceive themselves. And a young person, if I may just say one last thing before you ask your next question, a young person whom I shall not name, but who's more, as young people often are, more perceptive than people like you and me, a young person who follows Indian politics, told me, when I was explaining this pop psychoanalyst to him, he said, "Sir, Narendra Modi thinks he's like Chhatrapati Shivaji." And with this difference, Chhatrapati Shivaji was, though he was called emperor, he actually controlled only a small part of Western India, right? Whereas Narendra Modi is the first Hindu samrat to control all of India. So that's his self-perception. And that is why he cannot even share credit, forget with the good ministers in his cabinet, but even with the great Hindu leaders of the past.
You know, your statement that Mr. Modi loves himself reminds me of Oscar Wilde, who once said, "Falling in love with yourself is the beginning of a lifelong romance." The only problem is, this was a line in Oscar Wilde's play, The Ideal Husband. I doubt if that title would apply to Mr. Modi. Now, you made reference to the fact that Mr. Modi is an authoritarian prime minister, and that is certainly the perception of the opposition, of the press, and perhaps large numbers of people in this room. But let me put the opposite to you. In history, strong, decisive leaders are always thought to be authoritarian. Is that in fact a pitfall that Mr. Modi could not have avoided? Or do you genuinely believe that he is not just strong and decisive, but additionally authoritarian as well?
You know, what you say is undeniably true. So even in democratic regimes, forget in quasi-authoritarian regimes of today like the Putins and the Erdogans, but even in democratic regimes, if you think of a country you know much better than I do, the United Kingdom. Margaret Thatcher was strong and decisive. This lady is not for turning, as it was famously said. So you have had such cases in you know, De Gaulle, even more so, who thought the country was an extension of himself. But I think even Margaret Thatcher and De Gaulle, I think they had two things. One, they had some people they trusted. Secondly, they listened. So they knew, even if they were slightly contemptuous of their cabinet colleagues, they tried to understand, they had what is called a feedback loop. You know, what are people saying about their policies, their performances, their rising or declining popularity? And I wonder if Mr. Modi has any feedback loop, except for the BJP BJP president. And I'd rather not have a feedback loop than have that one.
All right, let's come at this point to the fault lines that beset our republic, and let's start with the minorities and the way they're treated. If you go back to 2014, we've been through Ghar Wapsi, Love Jihad, Bharat Mata Ki Jai, beef bans, Gaurakshaks, attacks on Dalits, and perhaps most recently the Namaz controversy. Do you get the feeling that India is becoming a majoritarian and intolerant state where the dictates of nationalism trump the liberal principles of our constitution, and as a result, Muslims and Dalits are marginalized?
Yeah, so let's talk about Muslims first. Absolutely. With this qualification, Karan, large parts of India. So I would say Hindutva majoritarianism, I should not call it Hindu majoritarianism, that would be an insult to many people in this room, you and me included. Hindutva majoritarianism is on the rise in many parts of India. It has been emboldened by the coming to power of the BJP. It has been further emboldened by the silence of the Prime Minister when the first horrific hate crimes occurred. But it is less visible, for example, where I live, across Karnataka, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. It is less visible. It is most visible in the Hindi heartland. So with that caveat, that it's not uniform. It's probably rising even, sadly to say, in some parts of South India, but more incrementally, in some portions like the Karnataka coast or in northern Kerala around Kannur. So with that caveat, absolutely, and it has been, and again, this is directly attributable to the Prime Minister, as many commentators have said before me, that if the first wave of hate crimes that occurred, including one just outside Delhi, the murder of Akhlaq is what I refer to, if something had been said, you know, but it wasn't. And that emboldened the next person and the next person. And then Adityanath was made chief minister of UP. And the signal was given. By the way, there was a statistic that is frightening for those of you who know our jobs problem. After Adityanath became chief minister of UP, at one stage, according to one report I read, several thousand young men every month were applying to join what is his organization called? The Hindu something Vahini.
Hindu Yuva Vahini.
Hindu Yuva Vahini, right. So what does this mean? It means, you know, just, you know, that is an open license. Making Adityanath chief minister is open license for macho vigilantes of the Hindutva right.
You sure it wasn't a clever way of creating jobs?
Well, there was no other way apparently of creating jobs. He was incapable of creating any other kind of job. So I would say with this caveat, Karan, I think this caveat is important because let's not homogenize all of India, right? Some states are less imperfectly run than other states, right? So, large parts of northern and eastern and western India suppressed hatreds and animosities against minorities have become stronger. Like just one other caveat I'd like to add. And again, some people may not be aware of this. Among some hardcore Hindutva ideologues, it may be bizarre to think this, but it's true. Among some hardcore Hindutva ideologues, including some active on social media, the hatred of Christians is even more than the hatred of Muslims. There have been some attacks on Christians too, and they were in Vajpayee's regime as well. But it just shows the kind of absolute bigotry where Muslims are relatively numerous. In some districts, they are large. We are surrounded by two countries where Islamic fundamentalism is rising, Bangladesh and Pakistan. You can never excuse Hindutva bigotry, but at some analytical level, you can understand why some of it is rising. There is terrorism. But the hatred of Christians, I mean, it is astonishing among some sections of the Hindu right how much they hate Christians. They still send their children to convent schools, And when they need a kidney operation, they still go to a mission hospital. That's a different thing, all right? But that to me, in some ways, the most frightening part of this bigotry. That even a tiny minority with no history of support from other countries, no association with global terrorism is also so demonized. Tells you something very worrisome.
I'll come to Mr. Modi's silence, which I'm sure concerns a lot of people in a moment's time, because I think it's something we should talk about in particular. But first of all, you know, the BJP has a sort of characteristic response when Muslims or Dalits, or for that matter Christians, as you mentioned, are targeted. Whether we're talking about what happens to Muslims in Kasganj or Alwar or on suburban trains between Delhi and Faridabad, whether we talk about Dalits not being allowed to ride horses, grow mustaches, or attend Dandiya festivals, or whether you talk about what used to happen fairly frequently a year or two ago, Christian churches, Christian statues being stoned and broken, and Christian churches being vandalized. The BJP said, this is ordinary crime. This mustn't be exaggerated and presented as villainy or as sectarian communal violence. How do you respond to that? Because there was even an attempt made, if I recall correctly, by Arun Jaitley to represent all the attacks on churches as ordinary crimes that had been booked by the police, and that the press and that the opposition were mistaken in giving it communal overtones. How do you respond to that defense they put up?
So I can't say about, because I've not studied at first hand, the attacks on churches in Delhi. But when it comes to attacks on Muslims, the record is very clear. It's been documented by the splendid website India Spend, which is, dare I say so in this room, as much a credit to Indian journalism as The Wire is. So give them a little money too. They do different kinds of work. They do data analysis and documentation. But if you look at their work on hate crimes and lynchings and cow-related lynchings and who is being victimized, you know, any statistical analyst will tell you that this is statistically significant. If you look at the insecurities that Muslims face, they withdraw into themselves, which of course has other tragic consequences, which is giving encouragement to radical elements in their own community. So clearly, if you look at the silence on it, see, Akhlaq was a good important, but Junaid Khan and many others, if you look at what the police has been doing in states like Rajasthan, when someone with a Muslim name is killed and the cases are filed against his family members, not against the accused. So on the question of attacks on Muslims, on the question of the behavior of the police and the state administration in these cases, on the absolute silence of ministers, chief ministers, cabinet ministers, and prime ministers, I think there can be no dispute. This is a hateful and majoritarian government.
You know, there was a time when the BJP was proud of presenting itself, I'm going back to the 80s and the 90s, as a party with a difference, by which they meant they were morally superior. There was a time when they used to attack other parties as being pseudo-secular, by which they meant you appease people, you aren't actually genuinely secular, you're treating them as vote banks. But I'm going to quote to you a series of statements made virtually every month this year by BJP MPs and MLAs about Muslims, and ask you at the end, what do you make of this aspect of the BJP? In January, a BJP MLA in Rajasthan, his name was Banwari Lal Singhal, said, the way the Muslim population is increasing, the existence of Hindus is in danger. In February, a BJP MP from UP, his name was Vinay Katiyar, said, Muslims got India divided. What is the need for them to live in India? They should either go to Pakistan or Bangladesh. What business have they in my country? In April, a BJP MLA in Karnataka, his name was Sanjay Patil, said, this is a Hindu Rashtra and we want to build the Ram temple. Finally, in May, a Rajya Sabha MP called Karan Thapar said, Muslims have been harassing Hindus and one should be very, very cautious about them. And absolutely no one in the BJP, minister, prime minister, or anyone else, criticized their colleagues for these statements. And you can find similar statements every single month, virtually, since they took over in 2014. What does this tell you about the BJP? And what does this tell you about the sort of things they're prepared to not just tolerate, but presumably find acceptable?
Yeah, I mean, before I answer your question, of course, one can quickly off the cuff, even a person who's gray and balding and losing his memory can remember other statements. You know, Giriraj Singh saying, if you criticize Narendra Modi, go to Pakistan. the other minister saying Haramzada and Ramzada, and they're still in the cabinet. So there are many, many other such statements. You know, what this tells you is that this is not Vajpayee's BJP, Balraj Madhok's BJP, Dindayal Upadhyay's BJP, anybody else's BJP. This is Modi and Shah's BJP. It's a ruthlessly majoritarian BJP. You know, what are the tragedies of living as long as I have and Karan has? That it induces certain nostalgia. You know, Rahul Gandhi makes me nostalgic for Indira Gandhi. Narendra Modi, believe it or not, makes me nostalgic for Lal Krishna Advani. Right. So, it's not even that. I mean, there is this amoral ruthlessness in the duopoly that runs the BJP that, and it may unravel, it's already been unraveling in the by-elections. There's this amoral ruthlessness that polarizes everyone against the non-Hindus, and we will win every election. I mean, look at the fact that there's absolutely been no, I think there was no MLA candidate from a minority community in UP, in Karnataka, in Gujarat, and you can go on and on. You can look at, you know, the appointments across the board, and sometimes aimed at Christians, by the way. Some of the people who may not have been elevated, perhaps it's not accidental what last name they have, right? So I think these are things that this is an amoral, ruthless BJP. It is not remotely even like the BJP I despised of Advani.
Let's come to the Prime Minister's silence. You spoke about it a moment ago. I've noticed, and I'm sure practically everyone in this room would have noticed, that every time there is an atrocity committed on Dalits or Muslims, every time there is a hateful rape, and God forbid we've had our fair share and more than our fair share of both of those in this country, every time a BJP MLA or MP says hateful things about Muslims or Christians, Mr. Modi is either silent, or if he does speak out, it feels as if it's been dragged out of him. And I can recall when Gauri Lankesh was murdered, that Mr. Modi, it was discovered, was following on Twitter people who were applauding her murderers. And in one instance, forgive my language, he was following a gentleman who called Gauri Lankesh a kutia. And when people protested and questioned, why is the Prime Minister following such people? Why doesn't he dissociate himself from them? Amit Malviya publicly said that the Prime Minister had a right in a democracy, in the interest of free speech, to follow whoever he wants. And my question is a very simple question. Do you believe Mr. Modi lacks moral leadership, or is he simply reluctant to exercise it?
Well, I suppose one of the manifestations of self-love is that you've never made a mistake.
In my school days, self-love was something very different.
Right, well said. So, I think part of it is he cannot say, "Mere se galti ho gayi." Mahatma Gandhi said, "I committed a Himalayan blunder." Right. But Mr. Modi has never made a mistake. But, you know, as important or interesting or worrying as the things Mr. Modi does not comment on is the things he comments on. So, when Gauri Lankesh or Sudhak Bukhari are murdered, there's no comment. But his heart bleeds for a forest fire in Portugal. He never fails to wish Amitabh Bachchan, Sachin Tendulkar, ABCD on their birthdays. Right. So it is something rather peculiar. As I said, you will have for your next wire dialogue, put Sudhir Kakkar and Ashish Nandi and maybe a younger psychoanalyst, three of them, and you ask them this question. I mean, it befuddles me. You know, it is astonishing what he says, what he does not say, his repeated references to himself in the third person, his desire to hug leaders who do not want to be hugged by him. I mean, an ordinary historian like me cannot give you a definitive answer to explain all these various strange behaviors.
Let me quote to you the opinion of two of the world's most highly regarded newspapers. On the 16th of April this year, this is what the New York Times wrote in an editorial of Mr. Modi. He has exhibited a pattern of silence and deflection that is deeply worrying to anybody who cares about the health of the world's largest democracy. Exactly a week later, on the 23rd of April, the London Times said, and I'm quoting again, he has been complicit in a culture that minimizes the very existence of these crimes, the crimes being the Unnao and Kathuwa rapes. How should we, as Indians, respond to the fact that two of the world's most highly regarded newspapers, in very critical personal terms, have these opinions of our Prime Minister? Should it be a matter of concern to us? Or should we say, as I'm sure the BJP does, this is just traditional Western prejudice and dislike of India?
Well, some sections of the BJP would say that. And the Prime Minister and the BJP President simply don't care. They don't care what the rest of the world thinks about us. I think early in his term, Modi might have. Early in his term, I mean, if I may invoke Ashish Nandi one last time, he wrote a wonderful book called The Intimate Enemy. And Jawaharlal Nehru is Narendra Modi's intimate enemy inside him. And somewhere early in his term, he thought, I will be the first Indian Prime Minister after Nehru to have an international reputation. And hence he went around and said some soothing things. But now he doesn't care, and his party president cares even less. They are only interested in winning the next election by whatever means it takes. You know, they are politicians. Every politician is ambitious. Every politician at one level is ruthless. But there are some politicians who are absolutely ruthless and amoral. Everything is instrumental about them. And at least over the last 18 months, Narendra Modi has stopped caring about what the international press, or of course even independent sections of the domestic press, say about him.
Two or three times you've used the adjective amoral to describe Modi. Why not immoral?
Look, that's an interesting question. You know, amoral is without a shred of morality. That is, you do not care for the consequences of your actions. And amoral goes well with the other adjective I've used, instrumental. You know, I think, for example, if you think of Indira Gandhi, since you mentioned Indira Gandhi a little while ago, Indira Gandhi had, again, to use a term from psychoanalysis, a divided self. One part of her wanted to do good for the country by her own lights. One kind part of her was a patriot. Another part of her wanted to be in power forever, and after she left, to install one son, then the next son, and so on. Right? But she was a divided self. But Narendra Modi, I think, is, you know, in that sense, not a divided self. It is all about himself, his glory, his fame, his power, and hence amoral. I mean, immoral, you know, these are quibbles, but I think amoral suits him better than immoral.
Okay. Let's come to the second fault line that, in a sense, besets our republic, the manner in which this government has treated critical constitutional institutions.
Yes, yes.
The opposition accuses the government of cavalierly dismissing governments in Uttarakhand and Arunachal Pradesh, of stifling its voice in parliament, particularly in the Rajya Sabha. The collegium of judges are upset because of the way critical transfers and promotions have been held up by the government, and the impasse between them over the memorandum that will determine the functioning of the collegium. And then, of course, there's the press, which accuses this government of politicizing the Election Commission and politicizing a whole range of investigative agencies. How much of that do you agree with, and how much do you think is just exaggerated?
None of it is exaggerated, and you left out some institutions. The universities, the Foreign Service, as I've discovered to my cost. Not to my cost, because I don't that care about it. But it would, I mean, this is just a personal anecdote, but it would, you know, other people in this room may also have experienced it. The Foreign Service has been explicitly instructed, and I've heard this from two different ambassadors, not to have anything to do with the guy sitting opposite you. When I travel, you know, I got an award in Japan some years ago, and it, you know what I think of Rahul Gandhi, and we may come to that in a minute.
I promise you we will.
Okay. But in no previous regime have critics of the existing government, if they were, let's say, you know, intellectuals, writers, musicians, been issued with an informal boycott. But even the Foreign Service has been told, don't hang around with ABCD. Don't be seen with them. You know, don't have dinner with in IIC with XYZ or anywhere else. Universities, and in the universities, which of course I deeply care about as a scholar, in the universities, it's partly to do with the fact that there are no intellectuals in the BJP or remotely connected with the BJP. But it's also partly to do with the hatred of the scholars and thinkers who are in universities. And what is deeply worrisome, if you think of JNU, there may be people here from JNU or Hyderabad University, which the wonderful poet referenced in her opening poem. You know, the attacks on JNU and Hyderabad University were led by the ABVP. I mean, it's again stormtroopers, young radical stormtroopers directing how our universities are run. So the judges, you know, I was there in the audience, and so were some others when you did that wonderful interview with Justice Telmeshwar. So we know what is happening to the Supreme Court. We know what's happening to the independent agencies. We know what's happening to the civil service. But it goes well beyond that. We know what's happening to the press. But the universities, the diplomatic corps, everyone is afraid. Everyone has to line up. If you look at, for example, again, I'm slightly more active on social media than you are. But less active than
I'm inactive.
Oh, you're inactive. Okay. But less active than people in this room. But if you see government officials, public officials, you know, your father was a public servant, my father was a public servant, you know. They would never do this kind of thing. If you see senior public officials and the craven, sycophantic tweets they utter about the Prime Minister and his policies, it tells you something deeply worrying about institutions. If senior public officials have to do this kind of thing, the army, certainly the chief has said things which no previous chief would have said, should have said, and I don't think, fortunately, at the moment, it's not widely shared within the army. I think there are senior people in the army who are deeply dissatisfied by the direction in which the government wants to take the army, right? But I think, and this is the poison they've left behind, which will outlive them. The poison of degrading and corrupting impartial public institutions that sustain this country. This whatever happens in 2019, that poison will take a long time to disappear.
Let me play devil's advocate with you at this point. How different, leave aside, how much worse? Just answer the question, how different is this government's treatment of critical constitutional institutions compared to Indira Gandhi's? Because when it's a question of superseding judges or dismissing government, she did it far more brutally and far more frequently. And when it's a question of disregarding the opposition or MPs, she didn't just disregard them, she jailed them.
Yes.
So when that is the comparison, and I know that whataboutery is not an effective academic way of responding to Mr. Modi's lapses, but the truth is that Indira Gandhi in Congress have inflicted much worse on our institution.
I completely agree. Indira Gandhi started it. She showed the way from 1969 till 1977. She showed the way. And that has given a license to these people to take it further. So there, I absolutely agree. I mean, perhaps this is not the place to talk about it. But I also agree, I also believe that we should not talk about what we are experiencing today as an undeclared emergency. I lived through the emergency and it was much worse. I mean, there are nasty things going on here, but don't use false and phony and misleading parallels. But having said this, you know, Indira Gandhi put people, well, it's a question of choosing. Indira Gandhi put people whom she thought would promote her policies, her so-called socialist policies, right? Which were mistaken, misguided. But here it is something more deeper and more insidious. And other institutions too. You know, one of the things that Indira Gandhi had, by the way, was a great respect for science. Indira Gandhi would never have allowed her education ministers to say Darwin was wrong. Never. And not once, twice, three times, four times. Indira Gandhi would never have said, as Narendra Modi himself said, that we invented plastic surgery. Right. So, in some ways, they've got even further. Of course, Indira Gandhi showed the way. Indira Gandhi and her cabal showed the way. And in that sense, you can use whataboutery. And of course, you're right. We are not living through an undeclared emergency. We are living through a period in which the ruling government is using public institutions to divide. But it is, if it was an emergency, you and I could not be speaking in Delhi. So let's not go into hyperbolic, you know, comparisons. But the poison they've left behind is, you know, Indira Gandhi has been gone 40 years. She was killed in 1984. Between 1984 and 2014, over 30 years, some of the credibility, some of the autonomy, some of the respectability to our public institutions was restored. So now we are going back to those days that she began.
Let me take another example with you. Let's take the example of Karnataka. The Modi government got a lot of flak in terms of the press, in terms of public opinion, about the way the outcome of the election was handled in terms of forming a government. But let me put a paradox to you. The Modi government was criticized for insisting that the Venkatraman principle, which President A.P. Sharma also followed, that the single largest party should be given the first chance, was the principle that they were standing behind. And instead, the opposition were demanding that a combination of smaller parties, if they have together a majority, should be called instead. But that's exactly what the opposition, in fact, stood against in Goa, in Manipur, and Meghalaya. So you have a very confusing actual situation where the two parties had switched sides and switched positions.
Yeah.
How much of a mess was this, and how much was this just the inevitable consequence of a difficult outcome, problematic outcome, and therefore not really a reflection of institutions being badly treated by Modi? And I'm deliberately putting this to you as a devil's advocate defense of his position.
No, I think you're right. I think what happened in my state was not calling Yediyurappa to form the government, was an exercise of judgment. You know, it was, you could disagree with it, but there had been precedents in the past. It's also the case that the institution of governor, the governor being made a political appointee, starts with Indira Gandhi. So that's not a, you know, that's not, on that issue, I agree with you. I mean, it's not something that one could hold the union government directly responsible.
While we're talking about Indira Gandhi, what do you make of Arun Jaitley's recent comparison between Indira Gandhi and Adolf Hitler? And would you accept the starting point, at any rate, that both of them used, in fact, a legitimate democratic republican constitution to acquire absolute power?
Yes, yes, yes. But I think what was more interesting than that comparison, which was probably meant to preempt other people comparing Adolf Hitler with other people, were the remarks in that blog about do not believe your own propaganda, for example, right? Now, there were some other remarks in that absolute power corrupts absolutely. No individual is more important than the institution. You know, if you look at the other, I mean, if they were inadvertent, that he needs to see a psychoanalyst too.
How are you so sure they were inadvertent? They may have been deliberately pointed, disguised as if they're referring to Congress,
perhaps.
But perhaps pointing in another direction.
But they were incredible. Those three things: absolute power corrupts absolutely. No individual is greater than the country. I think it was, and do not believe your own propaganda. Now, I think those were, but the question is, was Mr. Jaitley's boss listening?
Very interesting. Let's come to the third fault line that besets our republic. It's one that you and I discussed when we were, in fact, devising how we should handle today. And it's what you called the North-South divide. For most people, this most recently crystallized around the debate and the controversy concerning the terms and conditions for setting up the new finance commission. And I want to begin by asking you a simple question. Do you believe a North-South divide exists? And if it does, how serious is it?
So I think one has to go deep into history to explain it. But it's clearly the case that the southern states and some of the western states, Maharashtra and Gujarat, are doing much better economically than the northern and the eastern states on the aggregate. It's clearly the case that in the south, at least, attacks on minorities are less, though there are exceptions such as on the coast and so on. It's also clearly the case that women are less oppressed in large parts of southern India. There are more entrepreneurs. There's more migration into the south India, for example. You know, Kerala now has people coming from Orissa and Bihar. Bangalore has people, migrants from all over. So it's a hub of innovation, enterprise, economic growth. It's a place in which the fault lines of gender and caste and religion are less extreme as in northern and eastern India. And this should worry anyone. If one part of India is doing much better, it's more peaceable, economic growth is faster, innovation is more rampant, attacks on women are less, the other parts of India should think. And of course, there are deep historical reasons. It's got nothing to do with the fact that Karan Thapar lives in North India and I live in South India. Right. The deep historical reasons, we are coastal, so we've always been open to influences. We didn't see the horrors of partition. We were insulated from the wars that we experienced. You know, in Bangalore, where I live, has not known a war for more than 200 years.
We not since Tipu Sultan.
Not since Tipu Sultan. Not even black. I mean, Delhi, when you were growing up in Delhi, you would have had to blacken your windows. You knew what was going on. So all these reasons explain, to a large extent, why the South is doing better. But the South is upset. It's upset at having to subsidize northern states and eastern states. It's upset at the whole country being painted in a black brush because of things that are happening in certain states in the north. One of the nicest things that happened to me, that I felt personally, was when the BJP announced that Adityanath would march through Kerala to promote his party's chances. And in his first or second day, he said, "I will bring you my health system." And on the third day, he went back. Right. Now, that tells you something, right, about how the South is run and how the North is run. But this should be worrying to a republic. It should be worrying to a republic when, for example, southern chief ministers start thinking of a conclave, excluding everyone else, start feeling aggrieved that they're subsidizing the poorer parts of India. When southern intellectuals such as myself want to say, that please don't blame us for the nasty things happening in the north and the east. So I think these are things that are perhaps not as visible to the national media. I'll give you one last example, okay, which is relevant here to what's happening in Delhi today. 17,000 trees are being cut in Delhi. Many of you are rightly upset. Fortunately, the courts intervened. But do you know that in the Western Ghat, which is close to where I live, there are several projects being planned by the state and central government that may lead to the destruction of 750,000 trees with all the impact on the rivers of the Western Ghats. Now, does anyone cover this? The Wire had a story, by the way. The Wire had a very good story by two scientists based in Bangalore. First aid story on this. Do read it. But, I think whether it's for good or for ill, the South should mean much more to the Republic than it currently does.
And do you also feel that the BJP's policies, the BJP itself, with its Hindutva attitude, its stress on Hindi, is exacerbating the North-South divide, or is it ameliorating it? Because by coming to power, possibly one day, again, sometime in the near future in Karnataka, they might actually bridge it.
Well, I think the promotion of Hindi is absolutely counterproductive. And this government is more promoted to promoting Hindi than Vajpayee's government was. Because its understanding of nationalism is a paranoid understanding of nationalism in which the country is united on the basis of a single religion and a single language. But I think it predates this government. I mean, the fact is, it's just interesting for younger historians to speculate that why is it that UP produced most of our prime ministers and is still doing so badly? It produced most of our prime ministers because it has the most seats. And at the moment, there may be a fresh, there are calls in 2021 for a fresh delimitation of constituencies. So the more populous, more backward states of the north will be rewarded with even more MPs. So the southern states will be further marginalized, performing well on things like women's health, women's reproductive rights, and so on. So this is something that is a long-term thing. We can't blame a single government. But I think all concerned citizens should worry about it.
Now, I promised you, Ram, I would come to Rahul Gandhi. And this is that moment. There is a view that Narendra Modi is, in a sense, saved by the fact that his leading political opponent is Rahul Gandhi. Because many people, many who may be in this room, by the way, look upon Mr. Gandhi and say he hasn't got the qualities fitting of a prime minister. Look upon Mr. Gandhi and say he hasn't got the talent, he hasn't got the speaking ability a prime minister needs. Because he's perceived in that way, many people say Mr. Modi has the benefit of a huge Tina factor. Would you agree? Or would you say that's less so than it was 3-4 years ago?
No, broadly I would agree. I would agree, and this is not only because of the fact that Rahul Gandhi may be diffident, may not be a good orator, may not be entirely on the job 24/7, but it's more for sociological reasons. India has changed. The electorate is younger and younger and younger. No one remembers Jawaharlal Nehru, few people remember Indira Gandhi, and not that many really would remember Rajiv Gandhi. So you can't invoke lineage, partly because the electorate is younger. You can't invoke lineage because India has become a much more democratic and egalitarian society. I believe that, for example, among the reasons MS Dhoni is such a youth icon is that he's not from Bombay or Delhi or Bangalore, where all the old cricketers came from. You know, likewise with some of our entrepreneurs who are venerated, who come from all kinds of backgrounds. They're not Tatas and Birlas and Ambanis. India, young Indians want to know what you have done, not what your father or grandfather or great-grandfather did. And I think there's these structural sociological reasons which make people unwilling to be enthusiastic about Rahul Gandhi, even more than his personal characteristics.
You're suggesting, without saying it in so many terms, that the fact that he is a fifth generation Gandhi, the fact that he is a dynast, will always be held against him. It will always be the initial way, the initial prism through which Rahul Gandhi is seen. But there are many, and again, I'm sure many in this room who would say to you that over the last 1 year, either Rahul Gandhi himself or the public perception of Rahul Gandhi has changed. People say he's found a voice, he's found a sense of humor, he's able to be satirical in his Twitter feeds or whatever they're called. And in addition, perhaps he's outgrown his Pappu image. Would you buy any of that?
No. You know, Karan, if someone has been 14 years in politics, you would expect them to improve. You know, I've had, and there are people in this room, who've had PhD students who've been going for 8, 10, 12, 14 years. And they may sleep for 6 years, and in the 7th and 8th years, get some confidence and produce a few chapters. So I, you know, that's fine. He's been there a very long time. He may have improved a bit. But if at all his image is improving, it's not because of him, but it's because of the comparison. Because Narendra Modi has not delivered. Because Narendra Modi promised the moon and gave nothing. Because Narendra Modi has revealed himself to be unfeeling and amoral. You know, as someone, I'll give you two judgments of two people who are extremely close to me, personally, without identifying them. One said, when I was criticizing Rahul Gandhi, one said, at least he is not vile. At least he is not vile. So you know who was being called vile. At least he is not vile. Unlike the ruling duopoly, he is not vile. All right. That was one remark. The other remark of someone, also I should not name, but someone whom I deeply respect, said, in fact, an outstanding public servant, now retired, said, who has spent his entire working life trying to make this country a better place from within government, said, Rahul Gandhi will now have my vote, but he will never have my respect. So look at the comparison. At least he is not vile. He will not have my respect, but he will have my vote, because he is now pitted against someone who is seen by people as vile and unworthy of respect. So it is comparative. So if he has risen, it's not what because of what he has done or the smart tweets issued on his behalf.
He's a default choice.
Huh? He's a default choice. Precisely. He's a default choice.
Well, Rahul Gandhi, default and certainly no colossus, is not the only political figure on the opposition scene. To name just five others, you have Mamata Banerjee, Mayawati, Akhilesh Yadav, Chandra Babu Naidu, Sitaram Yechury. The question is, when you translate them onto the national platform, are they bit players or do they have significant roles? Do they matter nationwide or do they only matter regionally?
No, they only matter regionally. But each of them, I mean, I would leave Yechury out of it, though he's the guy I have most time for personally. But he can't win you many Lok Sabha seats, just as you and me can't, right? But so if you look
not
at,
even from Kerala?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I think the other people, it's CPM leaders in Kerala who have, you know, more. I mean, I was saddened that his party foolishly did not give him another term in parliament, because we need people like that. But he's not a vote catcher of any kind. But Mamata, Chandrababu Naidu, Mayawati, Akhilesh, these are people who can, you know, have a say in 30, 40 Lok Sabha seats, right? So in that sense, they are important. Now, I am not a close student of electoral politics. I'm sure journalists and editors in this room who understand that dynamic much better than I do. So, but that really, the question would be, as we approach 2019, Narendra Modi will try to make the election campaign presidential. Those opposing him will try and make it constituency by constituency, state by state. Now, that's how it will pan out. It's impossible to predict it. But because there is, Narendra Modi will clearly try to make it presidential, because he does have an all-India presence. He is recognized all across the country. He is a spectacular orator in a language spoken by a plurality of Indians, not a majority of Indians, but the most popularly spoken Indian language. So he will try to make it presidential, whereas, of course, those opposing him will try and make it local and regional. Now, no one really can predict how this will pan out. But it's pretty obvious that the positioning of Modi and the BJP will be presidential, and that of the opposition will not be presidential.
Let's end this section of tonight by actually forcing you to try and pan that out for me. Many people say that Mr. Modi cannot do as well in 2019 as he did in 2014, and the reasons are obvious, because he's going to lose seats in critical states like Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, UP, possibly Bihar, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh. But Amit Shah has gone on record several times to say that not only will Mr. Modi do better in 2019, but additionally, the BJP will get 50% or more of the popular vote. I know this is a tricky, awkward question and not territory you want to venture into, but end this part of the discussion by giving me some sense of what you think will be the outcome in 2019.
You know, Karan, I'm a historian, not an astrologer. Although to become an astrologer would be a profitable change of profession, right, in this country. So I'd say this, as of now, what you just said seems pretty plausible and accurate. In many states in the north and the west, the BJP is likely to lose moderately or substantially. And in the aggregate, in these five or six states that you mentioned, it could lose, as of today, 80 to 100 seats. However, what the duopoly has up its sleeve in terms of jumlas, you know, it's beyond your comprehension or mine. What they might do, what they might be thinking of doing, because they know the narrative is against them. How do they reclaim it? They can't reclaim it on jobs, economics, social peace, women's safety, Dalit rights, Muslim, none of that can they claim it. Good relations with neighbors, none of that. But what is the jumla they might have planned might be up their sleeve, you know, it's worrisome. And one can't speculate. But the only way I think they can stem these losses is by frightening people into voting for them.
And frighten the country, you're pretty certain they will try to do.
I don't know. They may have other jumlas in mind. You know, there could be ways in which one or another, money bag who's fled the country is brought back, and they say, we are against corruption, we brought him back. There could be other ways in which they could try and do this, spectacular stuff, you know. An equivalent of MS Dhoni's World Cup inning 6 without the happiness that ensued. Right. Okay. So we can't say. So, but surely they're thinking of that, because they know as well as you and me and everyone else in this room that in many states of northern and western India, the more populous states, they are likely to use a substantial number of seats.
Ram, we've covered extensive territory in the last 45, 46 minutes. Not just the three fault lines, but you've given us a fairly comprehensive idea of how you view the Modi government and how you view Mr. Modi himself. But also you've given us a fairly substantial peep into your understanding of Rahul Gandhi and the fact that you don't think any more highly of him than you do of Narendra Modi.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.